This lecture focuses on stem internal organization. And the picture that we see here is of a vascular bundle. We'll be talking about that in the second half of this lecture. The first part of today's lecture is going to focus on the organization of the very tip of the stem, or the apical meristem. The second part is going to focus on stems once they have been created by those apical meristems. So we'll look mostly at stems in cross-section, and we will compare the organization of dicot stems to monocot stems. We will see some important differences between those, and they will lead us to understand why monocot stems are unable to expand laterally while dicot stems are. Then we will go over the structure of woody stems, which are gymnosperm or dicot stems that have achieved secondary growth. Let's start by going over the structure of the apical meristem. Remember, the apical meristem is the region at the very apex, or the tip of the stem. This is where cell division occurs. Because we get the addition of new cells in this region, it is going to lead to stem elongation. Additionally, as cell division occurs in this region, most of the cells are going to differentiate into parenchyma cells or other cell types, and they will eventually cease dividing. However, there are going to be some regions of cells that the apical meristem leaves behind that still go through many repeated divisions. These are going to allow the apical meristem to leave cells that will eventually form leaves and axillary buds. Let's look at the structure now and some of the labeled parts. I'm not going to go in alphabetical order. Instead, I'm going to start at the very tip with this part labeled E. This is the apical meristem itself, and it fills approximately this region I'm circling. On both sides of it, labeled A and F, you see these almost ear-like appendages. These are going to be the earliest stages of developing leaves. And then further down, unlabeled, you can see these much larger appendages that look kind of like arms. These are leaves that have gone through subsequent cell divisions and cell expansion, and they are becoming closer to full-sized leaves. If we look further down from the meristem, just at the axil of this leaf, we see a region that stains darkly, much like the apical meristem itself. That's because this is another meristematic region. Specifically, this is a cluster of cells that was left behind by the apical meristem that is still capable of undergoing many subsequent divisions. And this then is going to be the axillary meristem, which you should remember occurs in leaf axils. The last thing I'll point out here are the structures labeled D. You can see several of them here. These are leaf trichomes. You should recall that leaf trichomes occur on the epidermis of leaves and that they serve several different functions that you read about. We're going to zoom in now and look more closely at the structure of the apical meristem itself, which was that very tip area on the stem. If one looks very closely with a microscope, then three different layers can be distinguished. The outer two layers, numbered 1 and 2 here, have cells that always divide sideways. So this cell, where my mouse is, its daughter cells, one would move this way and one would move slightly this way. The result of this is that the daughter cells always stay in the same layer. And if you imagine this process happening over and over as other cell division happens in this aqua layer here, the result is going to be that the entire outside of the above ground portion of the plant is entirely covered with cells from these two layers. In other words, these two outer layers on the apical meristem are going to form the epidermis of all of the stems as well as all of the leaves. So the entire shoot is descended from the daughter cells of the cells at the very top of this meristem here. Down within this aqua region, we still have cell division. This is still part of the meristem, but these do not divide all in the same direction. Instead, as these arrows indicate, some divisions are going to be to the side and some will be up and down, so it is less coherent, coherently divided into layers. And these cells are going to form the entirety of the stem. Let's discuss how the apical meristem leads to stem elongation. The basic idea is that as cells divide, they need somewhere to go. However, those cells cannot move downwards because there are already cells beneath them, that space is occupied. As a result, when the cell divides, the lower cell is going to more or less stay where it is, and the upper daughter cell is going to get stacked on top of it. Those two cells will then expand until they reach their full size. The result of the division and expansion is that the cells are going to get pushed upward continuously. Cell division occurs in this region at the very top of the meristem, but it continues down into the lower portions of the meristem. And eventually, at the very bottom of the meristem, we still have some cell division occurring. But as these cells divide, they are also going to differentiate into different cell types. The result of this differentiation down at the bottom of the meristem is going to be the formation of ground tissue, which remember includes collenchyma, sclerenchyma, and parenchyma, as well as the formation of vascular tissue. We have now completed describing how the apical meristem leads to the production of the stem. The next portion of this lecture will investigate how the different tissues in the stem are arranged.